Three ways to use URP renderer features. A renderer feature is a C# script that can be used at any stage in the render pipeline to affect the final render. Renderer features are a great way of adding custom rendering effects to your scene, often with no code required, so they can be very artist-friendly. A quick warning though, the first example is for coders only. If you're looking for artist-friendly examples, see the description and follow the timestamp links to the stencil example. In this video, we'll look at three examples. To code along with this video, get the repo from the description. You'll find two versions of the same project, one complete and the other a code along version. Both versions require Unity 2021.2, LTS or above. To code along, use the code along version. But I think you probably worked that one out already. First up, a simple example. We'll look at adding a custom post-processing effect using a C# script. Something experienced Unity developers will know. Using built-in, you would have added as a graphics blit using the onRender image callback. We'll use the version of the function that uses the material to process each pixel in the image. Open scenes, renderer features, tinting, small room, tint. We start by right-clicking in this folder and choosing Create Rendering URP Renderer Feature. Give it the name Tint Feature. Double-click the default tint feature file. It's a C# script containing do-nothing boilerplate for a renderer feature. Add these properties to the custom render pass class. The material will contain the shader we apply to the current state of the rendered image. We need to add a constructor to the custom render pass to initialize the material to use when processing this texture. We'll also initialize a temporary texture to store the result of processing the current render texture with our material. We also need to add a setSource method to initialize the source property of the custom renderPass class. We're going to need a shader to handle the tinting. Notice the simple shader graph shader tintSG. This is a shader with a texture modulated with a color. It's important that the reference for the texture is called underscore main text. We need to be able to choose a material to use in the tint feature. For that we need a settings class. We define it as serializable. It only needs a single property, material. Now we declare a serialized field property of an instance of the settings class. Using serialized field for a serializable class ensures it appears in the inspector. For more information, check out the serializing properties link in the description. The create function is called when the tint feature is created. We use it to initialize a new instance of the custom render pass class. Add a reference to the material selected in the inspector, which will be the one we created as a tint shader. We pass the material to the custom constructor. Notice we also set where this feature is used in the render pipeline, using the renderPass event property of a scriptable renderer feature. Now we've created an instance of the custom renderPass, we can add it to the render queue. The code goes in the addRenderPasses method. Here we set the source to the renderer, camera, color target, and enqueue the pass. Before the pass can do anything, it needs to get the temporary texture. Add this code to the onCamera setup. We get the descriptor from the camera data property of rendering data. This contains all the information required to create a render texture. For our purposes, we can ignore the depth buffer, so we set the bit depth to 0. Now we have all the data we need to add creating a temporary texture to the command buffer. Since we got a texture, we must release it. Add this code to on-camera cleanup. Now that everything is initialized, we can finally do the actual work of copying the current render texture using a material to process the results and passing this back to the source. In the execute method, get a reference to tint feature. Now we can use the blit method twice. Once copying the source to the temporary texture using the first pass in the selected material when copying, and then a second time copying the temporary texture containing the tinted version of the render from the first blit back to the source. Having set up the command buffer, we execute it and then release it. To see the effect in action, notice the main camera has a script attached, Auto Load Pipeline Asset. This script ensures when you load this scene, the renderer data object being used is tint_settings_renderer. Each example in the project uses a different renderer data object. If you're unfamiliar with using a URP renderer data object and a settings asset, then check the description for a great introductory level tutorial about using URP. Select this asset and use the Add Renderer Feature button. Tint feature will appear in the list. Make sure also to set Compatibility Intermediate Texture to Always. Now in the Settings panel, select Tint Matte. Use the inspector to adjust the color property of Tint Matte and see the effects in the game view. There are lots of tricks using renderer features, and in the next example we'll look at playing with stencils. To code along, open Scenes, Renderer Features, Small Room Stencil. Our aim is to convert the lens of the magnifying glass so it allows us to see through this desk, rather like X-ray specs. The approach is going to use a combination of layer masks, shaders and renderer features. The first step is to change the material that the lens uses. It will be the material called Mask Matte. Switch its shader to Custom Mask Shader. And open Mask Shader in your code editor and add ZRight off. Instantly the magnifying glass lens will disappear as the render order of this model is changed and it's rendered before the opaque objects in the scene. If you change its render queue index to after geometry, a number larger than 2000, then it will reappear. But leave it at 2000 for this scene. Now add two layers, mask and see-through. Place the lens in the mask layer and the desk, but not its children, in the see-through layer. This scene uses the renderer data object, see-through_settings_renderer. You'll find it in the same folder as the scene file, materials and shader. As the tint example, the script attached to the main camera, Auto Load Pipeline Asset, ensures this is set as the scriptable render pipeline asset in project settings graphics. To complete this scene, we're going to adjust the settings for this asset. The first setting change is the opaque layer mask. Have this not display mask and see-through. The desk will disappear. In the renderer features section, add two render objects features. Call the first mask and the second see-through. We want the first to use the event before rendering opaques and be filtered so it only works on rendered pixels in the mask layer. Expand the Overrides panel and click the Stencil checkbox. Set the value to 1. We want this to write the value 1 to the stencil buffer, everywhere where the lens is. It should also compare. Pass should be replace, so it always replaces the existing value wherever the lens appears, and fail and Z fail should be set to keep. The pipeline will attempt to render the mask layer. Because we don't set an override material, it will use the materials defined by the objects in this layer, which we know is just the lens with the mask mat that uses the mask shader. Using always compare and pass replace ensures that the stencil buffer, wherever the lens is in vision, will have the value 1 set for each pixel. Time to move to the second render objects. Set this to use the event after rendering opaques. So this will apply after the stencil buffer has been set by the mask. It uses the layer mask see-through. Again, we want to work with stencils and we're looking for the value 1. If we find the value 1, we shouldn't render the pixel. Our compare function is not equal. Pass is keep and fail and Z fail are also keep. This render object pass will only read from the stencil buffer, not write to it. So this pass will render any pixel in the layer see-through where the stencil buffer does not contain the value 1. It leaves the default render only where the lens is. Try changing the compare to equal and you get a flip result. The desk only shows in the lens. Renderer features are a great way to achieve some dramatic custom effects. A common problem in games is losing sight of the player character as they disappear behind environment objects. You could attempt to move the camera so the character is always in view, or adjust the environment to be as open as possible, but such options are not always possible. A great trick is to show a silhouette of the character when an environment model appears between the character and the camera. For this example, open scenes, renderer features, see behind. Haunted mansion, see behind. Firstly, we need a material to use when the character is masked. Create a material and set the shader to universal render pipeline unlit. Set the surface input's base map colour. In this example, the material is called See Behind. The aim is when a character disappears behind something, we'll see the character as a silhouette using the colour we choose here. To avoid rendering the character any more times than necessary, let's place him on a special layer. Select the character Fred, add a See Behind layer to the layers list, and select this for the character. You might also want to add the ghoul to the same layer. Select the renderer data object used for this scene. See behind settings underscore renderer. Now, using the opaque mask, exclude the see behind layer. The character will disappear. Click the add renderer feature button and select render objects experimental. Now we can set the settings for this render object's pass. Give it a name, choose when the render is triggered, here we choose after rendering opaques. Set the layer mask to the see behind layer, the layer we chose for the characters. Expand the overrides and set the material we first created. We do want to use depth when rendering, but we don't want to update the depth buffer by writing to it. The depth test will be greater. So this pass will only render when the distance to the rendered pixel is further from the camera than the distance currently already stored in the depth buffer, because there's an environment model between the camera and the character. At this stage, we only see the silhouette of our character when it's behind another object. We don't see the character at all when it's in full view. To fix this, we add another render object feature. Set the layer mask to see behind. This time we don't need to update the overrides panel. This pass will draw the character when not masked by another object. This silhouette trick is a great example of using the URP workflow to add effects that would have been difficult to achieve using the built-in workflow, and certainly would not have been available to an artist. Coding would have been required. I hope you can see how by using renderer features with the universal render pipeline, you can quickly create some great custom rendering effects.